The Brenda Perryman Show is brought to you by Livingston Family Dentistry.
Livingston Family Dentistry knows that good dental care ensures overall wellness, and healthy teeth and gums can perfect your smile. With over 30 years of experience, Dr. Ronald and Dr. Blake Livingston take the time to explain every treatment. Their modern office and friendly staff are committed to making you feel comfortable, informed, and satisfied. Located at 13724 Woodward in Highland Park, call now, 313-883-3050.
If your teeth are not becoming to you,
then you should be coming to us.
Good morning, everybody. Henry Tyler says, I'm hot, so I must be hot this morning here on TV 33 WHPR. And I think camera one is my camera, so that's the one I'm looking at. I hope I see you. I'd like to first say this morning the prayers go out to the people who lost their lives on Woodward Avenue this morning in a horrific accident that took place in Highland Park overnight. And our prayers go up for the family of those people who did not make it. Very, very sorry. Very sorry. Hated to hear that. So God bless you, and may God console you, and you get the support of others also. Now, welcome to my show this morning. I have a jam-packed show for you this morning. I'm very excited about it. The first, we're going to talk about real estate issues in Detroit, of values in Detroit, and everything with a realtor. Then we're going to talk a little foster care and other things. And we're supposed to have a piece of entertainment, but we'll see how that goes. Anyway, I'd like to first introduce you to my guest, Mr. Reginald Perryman. Good morning, Reginald.
How are you doing, Brenda?
I'm fine. I know you say, well, Perryman. Yes, Perryman. Reginald is a cousin of mine, and he's here, and he was one of the best people I could get to talk about this subject, because a lot of us or people are concerned about real estate, their housing values in Detroit, whether or not homes are going up and everything. But let me first talk to Reginald a little about himself. Reginald, I remember exactly when I met you. I was teaching in Highland Park, and I knew your mom. But I had never met you, and I was teaching in Highland Park. I was walking down, getting ready to walk down those stairs, and you said, Ms. Perryman, I'm Reginald Perryman, I'm your cousin, you know. I said, oh, really? Didn't know that. But that was a long time ago, and you've grown into a wonderful, wonderful young man. You graduated from Highland Park, right?
Yes.
Speak up into the mic.
Yeah, I graduated from Highland Park in 1991, actually.
Wow. Yeah. So I left right after your freshman year, left and went to Southfield Public Schools. But Reginald has been very supportive of me and my endeavors also. So Reginald, what made you decide to go into real estate?
Actually, I got into real estate. My grandmother was into real estate. She was an investor as well. And around when I turned 19, I actually went and pursued real estate as a
19?
Career. Yes.
That's pretty early.
Yes, it is.
But it's good to learn from that time.
Exactly.
So you've amassed quite a bit of knowledge, I'm sure. Yeah. So what I wanted to talk to you about, well, first maybe you tell me, so what did you do? Did you sell a house first, or did you go about renting, or when did you get your license?
Yeah, I got my license when I was 19. I You know, I went to school, and, you know, at that time you had to pass a state test, which is currently the law now, right, and to obtain your real estate license. And I started out at Century 21 office, uh-huh, and I worked there for 10 years before starting my own company.
Oh, okay. And your company is Ritz Realty.
Ritz Realty, yes, and we're located in Oak Park, Michigan.
Ritz Realty. Why don't you name it Ritz?
It was a decision. At that time, I had a partner, and we just kind of came up with a name.
Well, wonderful, wonderful. Now, Detroit, we all know, I remember years ago when, before my third child was born, we were looking for a house in Detroit. And there were certain areas we wanted to move in. Right. Every time we got to a house, it seemed like it was moving just like this. We couldn't even get a house in Detroit. We were looking in the Sherwood Forest area. We were looking over in Rosedale Park and so forth and so on. Just couldn't get a place.
Right.
Now, things have flipped. They've totally changed.
Exactly.
Can we talk about that?
Yes. Actually, we're back to that scenario where right now there are homes on the market. Any home that you look at is pretty much, you know, the term highest and best is a word that's used now, meaning that there's multiple offers on a property and the banks are asking for your highest and best offer.
In Detroit?
In Detroit, surrounding areas as well.
Oh, wow.
And okay, this is mainly due to the banks at one point in time, they were just overcrowding the market with properties. Now they're not putting as many homes on the market, so the demand is higher.
Oh, so these are foreclosed homes.
Foreclosed homes.
So they're intentionally keeping some homes off the market.
Exactly. And that's what it is. It's a result of all the foreclosure options that they're giving homeowners. So the properties are not being foreclosed on as quick as they were 2 or 3 years ago. So they're not hitting the market.
Which is a good thing.
Exactly. And it's increasing. It's helping increase the values of the properties in Detroit as well.
Good, because a lot of people are concerned because they feel like they're underwater with their houses. They're paying this note that they started paying when the house was worth a lot more, right?
Exactly. And that's the thing that we're dealing with now is people that maybe purchased their homes between 2000 and 2005, we're probably not going to see those values again for another 5 or 10 years. But prices are increasing. They're just not going to reach back to that 2005 peak value some time. Well, it's going to take time, but the prices are increasing at this time.
Would that be contingent on area?
Yes. Yeah. There are some areas that the prices are, you know, pretty much close to where they were 5, 6 years ago.
Now, what area is that?
I mean, you have areas. I mean, you look at areas like Sherwood Forest, Palmer Woods, where you have multiple offers on homes and people. The funny part is a lot of people are actually just paying cash for homes. And
cash?
Yeah. I mean, we sold properties. I've been in real estate 21 years, and the past 3 years, I have never seen so many cash transactions in all of my real estate career. This is not just your $10,000 and $20,000 home. So I'm talking about people are paying, you know, $300,000 cash for homes. And this is a market where anyone that was sitting on any money, they're spending it now.
Wow. What do you think accounts for that?
I think it's pretty much just a matter of people were looking for a good opportunity, the right time to buy.
Well, Detroit has some really nice homes.
Yes.
Some historical homes, too, and the structures are quite good.
Exactly.
And so, in a way, it would be a boon to a person to buy a home in Detroit. Let's talk about downtown Detroit and its vicinity right now for a minute. It seems like, well, we know a lot of real estate has been bought down there, and they have, people have recovered older buildings and revamped them, and they made condos out of them and so forth. And they're not cheap.
No, they're not. What's happening is people are somewhat creating their own value for a property. For example, a property, you may see a property that's worth to you $10,000, but someone else may see a different value in it based on what their use is for the property. So you may have a property, for an example, I had a client that bought an Indian Village. he actually invested more money into the property than what it was worth to rehab the property because of the value that it held for him personally. He was impressed by the architecture of the property
and things of that nature.
Yeah,
real nice architecture. Well, let's talk real quick. Well, I want to go over to Northwest Side. I remember when I was coming up, the Northwest Side over near Mumford and all of that, that was just the stuff. I live in Northwest Detroit. I never got there, but anyway, I live in Northwest Detroit, people would say, and that was really the thing. And then what happened there? It just seemed like...
I think a lot of it is a result of the economy in whole. You had the foreclosure crisis, and things like that really affected Detroit as a whole. And it just happened. It was an end result of the overall economy. When people were losing jobs, losing their homes, the homes were vacant. The people that had good income, a lot of them chose to leave. So that affected the area in general. And that's one of the reasons that we're seeing some recovery.
People rented. They started renting some of the homes.
Right. You had a lot of investors that were buying properties and just renting the properties out. And you had quite a few people that were actually, just like you said earlier, underwater. They decided just to leave their
walk
away altogether.
And then some people pass away, and the younger people get the homes, and sometimes they don't put the value on the homes. They don't do the lawns like their predecessors did, and so forth and so on, and the value of the property goes down. You just have to constantly upkeep your house, don't you?
Yes. What I notice a lot with our generation coming up, a lot of us moved to Atlanta or out of state. And if our parents or our grandparents passed the family home, we didn't return back to maintain that property. A lot of us decided to just let the home go.
Oh, that's so unfortunate. Yeah. Now, if there's a person out there in my audience who has a home, they're thinking about selling and maybe even staying right in Detroit, because everyone who sells a home in Detroit doesn't move out of Detroit.
Exactly.
They want to buy a home in another area of Detroit. What should they do to prepare their property?
Well, the first thing they want to do is get a market evaluation from a realtor to determine what the value of the property is. So right now, the biggest thing is pricing. And then we have to look at the overall condition of the property. Detroit requires a pre-sale inspection, so you have to have the property inspected by the city of Detroit and comply with all those repairs that are required.
We have a call from Charles.
Okay.
Good morning.
Good morning.
How are you?
I'm doing fine.
That's good, Charles.
Excuse me?
That's good.
Good morning. How are you?
I'm just fine. You had a question?
I don't have a question so much as a statement I'd like to make to the young man that thinks that all of the housing market collapse was just something that just happened because the car companies went belly up. So he's got to realize this was all by design, okay? They call it a reset of America, okay? Too many people were moving in places where they weren't wanted, and the only way to prevent it was to stop the flow of cash, okay?
Yeah, I think there was a lot of predatory lending going on, too.
Well,
people were getting houses who weren't qualified for houses just so that the mortgage companies or the predatory lenders could get that money.
Mm-hmm. Well, that was the way to get people out of a lot of homes that were wanted, because people bought homes farther out in Oakland County and thereabouts, and they were made of cardboard and stuff. And these homes were built with the best materials that you could come across in life, and they wanted them back.
Well,
so
I can
see who's coming back to town now. So that should tell you what's going on.
I can say this, that in cases you're right, because it's a combination of all the factors involved, the predatory lending, and we know what's going on, but pretty much right now it's an opportunity for us to buy these properties. We're looking at
if you save your money, but don't ever forget that story about the Pied Piper. Okay. You remember that?
Yes. Right now we're in the market. I'm looking at, we have people that are buying in Detroit from all over the world, not just,
absolutely,
you know,
right,
out,
right,
outside. We have clients coming from the UK. They're,
absolutely,
buying these properties in bulk. The thing that I noticed personally as a realtor is that it seems like everyone is taking advantage of the opportunity except the people that are in the area. So,
okay,
you know, we reach out to people and say, look, the home next door to you is for sale for $5,000 or $10,000. You know, you can partner up with a neighbor and purchase that property.
That's right.
People are not taking advantage of the opportunity. So right now, the opportunity to buy and own in your city is there, but you have to take advantage of it. But if you don't, someone else will.
But see, we're coming from a generation now that was so selfish. So naturally, they're going to miss the opportunity because they're selfish. Okay, but this is the only city, I believe, that sits on two borders, the United States and Canada. Okay, and people are buying in Detroit because they realize that it's on an international border.
Right, right.
Okay.
Well, thank you, Charles. We have some more calls.
You're welcome, dear.
This morning. Thank you so much.
Bye-bye. You have a blessed day.
Thanks for your insight.
Thank
we
you.
Have Renee on the line.
Hey,
good morning, Renee.
Ask your cousin three quick ones.
Uh-huh.
What does sight unseen mean? And I'm interested in buying vacant lots. Now, when you buy a vacant lot, the only thing is there's no mortgage, right? And only thing you have to worry about is taxes and the upkeep, like cutting the grass and if it's a sidewalk nearby, shovel the snow. Now, we have and then I want to know legal description. We had a situation here in Pontiac where the senior brought one of our community centers, and the city reneged on her, saying that she only had the building, and she didn't buy the baseball field, the parking lot, and the other parts, a lot of acres to that, and she's in court with that. But on her legal description, it said that all that's included. Now, how are you just going to buy the building if you're not just going to get the parking lot and the driveway to get in there? And I just don't know if you think that she got
piece
to her case.
Weird.
Well,
okay, go on.
Let me answer the first question. Sight unseen goes back to what I mentioned earlier with the investors and people from out of the country buying the properties. See, what people don't realize is that the internet is your best friend and your best enemy at the same time. People from all over the world are seeing these properties on the internet. They're pouring money into the properties. They never come here to visit the property. That means sight unseen. They're looking at the dollar value, the return on their investment. They can care less about the overall property, seeing the property and things of that nature. They want to know how much it's going to cost to purchase, how much it's going to cost to rehab, and what the return on their investment is going to be. So as a Detroiter, if you're living in an area, while you're looking at the property thinking about how bad it is, someone else is looking at it as an opportunity, and they're buying it sight unseen.
Well, is that one man's junk is another man's treasure?
Exactly.
Okay.
Exactly.
We just have a few more minutes, so okay. Can you, what was that? Well, she was talking about
the vacant lot?
Yeah.
The vacant lot issue, it sounds like the person who purchased the property should have obtained title insurance, had a title search, and also had a survey. If you would have had a survey done prior to closing and made your offer subject upon reviewing the survey, it would have told you exactly where your lot lines land.
Oh, okay.
Okay, right. And then when you purchase vacant lot, the only thing you're responsible for is the taxes and the upkeep?
Correct.
Okay.
Always, when you purchase a vacant lot, always secure a survey. If you're buying any real estate, but mainly when you buy a vacant lot, because the survey is going to determine where you can build on a property.
Okay, yeah, cause I was just going to buy the lot and then sell it to someone else. I'm not into the house and thing, but I just, you know, want to give buy the lot, just the lot.
Right.
The empty lot. And then the situation with our community center, do you think that case has some teeth? but she had the legal description and it was included, but the city reneged on her.
I would say just contact a real estate attorney.
A real estate attorney?
Yes.
Okay, thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Okay.
Wow, you know, there's so much with this real estate that I have to have you come back.
Okay.
Like, will you do that for me?
Of course.
Because we haven't even gotten to all my questions, all my questions about property. Here in Detroit, people getting ready to buy property and everything. There's so much to do. Reginald, Rich Realty, if
yes.
somebody in my audience has another question for you or are interested, what is your number? Why don't you give your contact information?
You can contact me at 248-440-5226.
And email?
My email is rperryman@ritzrealtydetroit.com.
Perryman, P-E-R-R-Y-M-A-N.
Yes.
I know how to spell that. But thank you so much, Reginald.
You're welcome.
And there's so much we have to do because I think, like you said, people are buying property here from all over the world. We have to take advantage of that.
Yes.
Even if I have to get with Pookie, Ray Ray, and somebody else, we can buy some property,
exactly.
Right?
Exactly.
Somebody had got some good credit up in there. No, I'm just kidding. Okay, everybody, we'll be back in just a minute with Mr. Thomas. We'll see you in a moment.
The Brenda Perryman Show is brought to you by Livingston Family Dentistry.
Livingston Family Dentistry knows that good dental care ensures overall wellness, and healthy teeth and gums can perfect your smile. With over 30 years of experience, Dr. Ronald and Dr. Blake Livingston take the time to explain every treatment. Their modern office and friendly staff are committed to making you feel comfortable, informed, and satisfied. Located at 13724 Woodward in Highland Park, call now, 313-883-8255.
If your teeth are not becoming to you, then you should be coming to us.
Renee King Jackson sings Mahalia, a soulful toe-tapping musical reflecting the life of the greatest spiritual singer in the world. Sunday, April 21st at the Shriner Silver Garden Center at 24350 Southfield Road in Southfield, Michigan at 7 p.m. For ticket information, call 248-569-8834 or visit the web www.reneekingjackson.com.
I love that song. I just love that song. Good morning. Once again, this is Brenda Perryman, and this is the Brenda Perryman Show right here on TV 33 WHPR, Comcast 20 in Detroit. And I'd like to tell a mother out there, one of our mothers and everything, that I'm going to be offering. This will be the Friday prior to Mother's Day, and we'll give you more details on it next week. But we will be talking about, I will have one mother from my audience get a free makeover, makeup and everything done that Friday morning and be on the show. So we will talk about it next week. I'm excited about it, to make over a mother, do some nice things for her, because the job is hard. But anyway, speaking of mother, speaking of parents, We're going to introduce my next guest, and that's Mr. Robert Thomas, Robert E. Thomas. Good morning, Robert.
Good morning.
How are you?
I'm great.
Friend of the show. He's been here before. He's a law student, right? Aren't you getting ready to graduate soon?
In December.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
And you're going to understand the congratulations when you find out where Robert came from and how he came to be where he is. Also, you just got appointed to the Zoning Commission, didn't you?
Yes.
Congratulations.
Thank you again.
Gee, you're just a wonder man. And it shows you, he's going to show you that no matter what your circumstances are, if you make the right decisions and then you get some blessings here and there, you can really achieve. So, Robert, you were born here, right?
Yes, I was born in Detroit, Michigan, Henry Ford Hospital.
Oh, Henry Ford.
Absolutely.
Oh, Henry Ford. tell us what happened with your life. Why don't you, you're the best one to give my audience a background there.
Oh, sure. And just keeping it simple, I went into the foster care system around the age of 6 years old. And I've been in and out of the foster care system due to abuse and neglect of parents, that is. And
you live with different families?
Yes, I've been in a total of seven different foster homes off and on. And actually, I left out of the foster care system at the age of 14. And then I went into an independent living program.
So you were that age when you went into independent living?
Yes, when I was actually 16 when I went into independent living program, but I went back at the age of 14 and went back to live with my biological mother. So I started off, in fact, in a group home at the age of 6 years old. It wasn't regulated at the time what age you can actually go into.
Tell the audience what a group home is.
It's a home of boys, five or more in a house.
And they still go to school?
They still go to school, and you have a guardian that's overseeing you and make sure,
So was it hard to concentrate in school? And how many schools did you go to?
It wasn't entirely difficult for me to concentrate in school. School was my relief mechanism. I knew I was going to get meals there. And I love math and science, and that's why I became an engineer.
Gee, I might not have made it if I was in a group home, because I hate math and science. And they cut out the arts, so I'd be up the creek. Well, anyway, no, I was just drifted. good you did like math and science,
yeah.
And it was a relief to get in there, and it stimulated your brain, didn't it?
Yeah, and that's not it. I actually have seven other siblings, and I am the only one actually
blood
made
siblings?
It to blood siblings.
Oh.
And I'm the only one that made it to where I am at today. Of course, the foster care system itself is pretty traumatizing to a kid.
Well, I want to go back to where you graduated from high school.
Oh, okay. Actually went to Bobian Middle School, which was, I think it's Bates now, Bates Academy. But I actually graduated from Northwestern High School here in Detroit.
Right, the big N-O.
The big N-O, that's right.
And then you went where?
I went to University of Arkansas, Pine Bluff. I played football, ran track there. And transferred to North Carolina A&T State University, and I graduated my BS in mechanical engineering and my master's in industrial technology, manufacturing systems.
And then you took a turn for the law.
Well, before that, I became a nuclear defense engineer with one of the defense contractors in Naval Sea Systems Command as a contractor, and then I came here to law school.
So you didn't like the engineering profession?
Actually, I liked it, but I figured, I have a calling for the law, and I was, my senior year in college, I actually wanted to go to law school, and I didn't make that move until I actually came across a recruiter in
But you know that DC. A lot of times things, we get that inkling for something else, and then we don't act on it right away, but it stays with us, and that's probably what happened to you.
Oh, yeah.
It stayed with you, and so the law, you like the law, you love the law.
Yeah.
That's good. What kind of law do
you want? I want to go into patent law, patent and trademark, the intellectual property industry. And what I also want to do, and which what the law came in at first, was dealing with the foster care issues.
Right.
As an advocate for the foster care system, dealing with child advocacy and juvenile justice issues.
It is so necessary. That is so necessary because a lot of students, not students, young people, sometimes get abused in the foster care system, don't they?
Yes, they do.
Can you tell us about some of the what's happening with foster care right now?
Well, I've been to, like I said before, about 6 or 7 different placements. A number of things have happened to me and going through different foster homes.
Now, don't you talk to, aren't you on a board or something about foster?
Yes, I'm also on a foster care review board for the state of Michigan.
And what does that board do?
We sporadically pick out cases dealing with foster care issues, and we review them. We interview the foster parents, the foster child if they want to, caseworkers, both the contracting side and
now,
the state side.
Do the foster children ever get a voice? Do they get a chance to be heard?
Actually, within the review board, we encourage kids to come and actually speak on their own behalf. They would know best what's happening in the homes.
Do you find any common issues with the foster care that the young people voice?
Yes. One common issue I've seen and I advocate for all the time is the lack of mentorship. These kids, like I said before, they've been traumatized in so many ways. They need mentors out there other than a foster parent, because a foster parent doesn't mean that you're going to be in their lives or that effective in their lives.
The foster parent just is there to house them and clothe them and
in a lot of cases, yes. I could say in most cases you have a parent there, but in a lot of cases you know they are there as a figurehead, if not.
What is the maximum amount of young people that can be in a foster care home?
I'm not sure what the limitations are as far as a kid in an actual foster care home. Like I said, they still have group homes out here now, and I'm not sure what the limitations are on that number.
Because when I was teaching, I taught a lot of young people who were in group homes or they were in foster care. Some of them had some really great experiences, some of them did not.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, and they found school to be a refuge also.
Yeah, what happens is you have some homes that go into it for the money, and as small as that is, they still want to go into there for the money. And as many kids you get, the more money you get. Then you have a kid with special needs, the more money you get. You get more government assistance.
Oh.
But all the kids actually want is a loving home. They want to be treated normally. Like a normal kid that you would raise, no differently.
So what are your concerns with the foster care system right now?
Well, like I said before, one of my concerns is
mentorship. How can you be a mentor? I mean, how would one, say if I have an audience member who has raised their children, they're maybe retired, they have something to offer a young person, how would they go about it?
Well, you have programs out there like Child Help, Big Brother, Big Sisters, and they can identify
certain
kids.
Where are the Big Brothers, Big Sister programs now? Because I've done some things with one that was out in Southfield at one time, but I don't know.
I want to say their headquarters is still in that Southfield area. It's Metro Detroit, Big Brother, Big Sister, so they service the whole metropolitan area.
Mm-hmm.
But another concern of mine would be the education rate. You have 70%, maybe slightly below, that graduate from high school. This is like 400,000 in the nation that is in foster care, and only 3% go on to obtain a bachelor of science degree.
Really beat the odds. Yeah. You really beat the odds, Robert. So why is that, though, about only 3%?
I could say that you have a myriad of issues there. you're being placed from home to home. I've known
right,
people.
But what can the foster care system do about encouraging or changing that?
You know, one thing I speak about all the time is encouraging stabilization in one foster home. A kid doesn't need to visit 10 different homes. And when I say visit, I mean, you have foster parents that encourage kids to call them mom and dad and things like that. And that's, like I said before, it's traumatizing the kid to be reintroduced to different homes.
Another mom and dad.
Having to call them mom and dad. And another issue I can say that I'm an advocate for is in which Western Michigan University, and you have Wayne State University here, what they're doing, they've started foster care groups at the universities.
How do those work?
Well, they identify the foster kids and they work with them, provide them resources, some monetary benefits. I believe they get some stipends from time to time.
The kids?
Yes. And one of the reasons for that is, once you're in a foster care system, 9 times out of 10, you don't know your parents. You have minimum involvement with your siblings, although they do encourage that. But you don't have a family relationship. That means, you're on spring break, you don't have a home to go to. You on Thanksgiving break, well, there's no one to eat Thanksgiving dinner with. I recall times in college in which I snuck in a dorm just to stay there because I didn't have anywhere else to go. But things like that, I encourage those college programs in which they bring the foster kids together and have these type of family dinners with and things like that.
Gosh. It breaks my heart, to think. And a lot of people don't realize how many young people there are who don't have a place to go on those special days when school is out so they can't go to class. And
yeah, you have to think, I believe in the state of Michigan, you have about 14,000 kids in the foster care system and close to 700 age out every year. And that means only 3% of them are graduating from college, which is maybe about 6% actually going, and only 3% are graduating.
Well, if they don't go into college, what about training programs?
And that's another topic. When they don't go to college, you have, especially amongst the male population, at least 80% of them are being incarcerated. And 70% of the women there are seeking public assistance. So tackling these issues, especially with mentoring them while they're young, encouraging them to go into a healthy foster home because, all they want is someone to love them and to treat them normally as if they're their kid. I don't care if it's rich, poor, middle class. They just want love. And to be a part of the family.
Wow. Do you have some other statistics that you'd like to talk about?
I believe that's about it.
Okay. So I could get back to talking about what can we do? What can we do?
Well, I encourage, May is Foster Care Awareness Month. That's and I encourage those who can become foster parents. Like I said before, and I'm going to keep hitting on these points.
Well, I've had Spalding for Children on. I've had Addie Williams of Spalding for Children on. I've had Michael Williams with Orchards Family Services on before. I know both of them. So do people have to go through agencies like that, or is there a city agency?
No, there are several agencies. You have Lutheran, Social Services, you have Catholic Social Services, which they're still here today. I was a part of that agency. Spalding, you have a bunch of agencies out here that provide both foster care and independent living semi-independent living programs.
Tell our audience what that is, because I've had students in that too, and some have really succeeded.
Well, the semi-independent SIL, semi-independent living programs, are in which the kid would get a stipend to live in your home.
Right.
They pay, I believe, up to $300 a month. And what you're doing, you're not being mom or dad because they're trying to live independently and make some dependent choices. But you are serving as somewhat as a mentor.
I had one young man who was in semi-independent living. And the woman whose house he was in, she would support him. He was in the theater program. He was in other things. And she would support by coming out to his events and so forth. Yeah. So, I mean, even though he was independent, it was just some kind of support. And he spoke of her fondly.
Oh, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Uh-huh. So I think that that's another thing that people, how do you get a young man or young woman who's semi-independent?
Well, I believe you need to be at least 16 years of age, you need to be on an independent living track with the courts.
The system.
Yeah, the court system.
The system.
Juvenile justice, that court system.
You know, a lot of people equate that with being in trouble.
Not necessarily. Because you're with the juvenile courts, and they're in a juvenile and family courts, and where they oversee your case as a foster kid.
Yeah, I understand that. I think a lot of people don't understand that, and I wanted them to know. Now, independent living for a young person.
Okay. Well, I'm not too familiar with the independent living programs. I do know about the semi-independent living programs. So, like when I came into independent living, when I was in independent living program, which has changed dramatically since I've been in the system. I think it was the Urban League's first program, and I came through that program in which I worked, at that time, two jobs, went to high school to pay my rent. There was no subsidy given at that time. And that's the only program I can, talk
point
about.
Two.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, in the interim, you've discovered family, haven't you?
Oh, yes, yes, yes.
A lot of family that you didn't know before.
Yes.
How did that happen?
I probably say about 5 years ago, I went to a family reunion. One of my relatives contacted me and said, "Hey, it's a family reunion in Chicago." And I was visiting one of my buddies, one of my fraternity brothers in Chicago. And I popped up on the scene. I didn't know anyone. And it was a heck of a moment because I didn't know I had family in Detroit, which was really, really crazy. And then maybe about, was it a year or two ago? One of your producers,
one of my producers. Yeah, I'm on it. I'm on ABC. Michelle.
Yeah.
My wonderful
Michelle.
Yeah. I went
to, one of my, relatives, funeral actually. And I actually met Michelle there and been in contact with, that side of the family ever since. And that's another thing I encourage also is while you in care or after you get out, try to trace your roots as a foster kid.
Well, that's important too for a number of reasons, including health history.
Oh yeah,
health history.
I've discovered since I've been in contact with a bunch of my relatives that once again as African Americans we suffer from different types of cancers and diabetes and things like that. And I believe the colon cancer issues are pretty prominent in our family. So,
Well, Robert, thank you so much. Now, what can we do? Once again, tell my audience what they can do if they are interested in foster care, adopting or taking in somebody.
Well, contact your local Department of Human Services or one of the agencies, and especially agencies since they oversee the foster care in the system. And if you are alumni of CARE, contact us at fcaa.michigan@gmail.com. Look at us on Facebook at Foster Care Alumni of America, Michigan. Or contact us on the internet at www.fostercarealumni.org.
Wonderful, 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 because you can support each other.
Yes, and that's one of the things I've done since I've come back here is started an organization called the Foster Care Alumni of America, the Michigan chapter. So we can provide some support for one another. And in fact, we have a picnic coming up July the 28th at Milliken State Park downtown.
Oh, yeah. I'll be there.
All right, all right.
Hey, I'll do the Soul Train line.
All right.
Listen, congratulations to you for all your endeavors. And after you become a patent lawyer, and you're going to be wonderful, because there's something I got to ask you. All right, everybody, we'll be back in just a moment with Miss Mahalia herself, Renee King Jackson. Just because you care for me, why should I feel uptight? Love had to show me one thing. I was so right, thought I could turn emotion. All in all, I was so sure, I was so sure.
Livingston Family Dentistry knows that good dental care ensures overall wellness, and healthy teeth and gums can perfect your smile. With over 30 years of experience, Dr. Ronald and Dr. Blake Livingston take the time to explain every treatment. Their modern office and friendly staff are committed to making you feel comfortable, informed, and satisfied. Located at 13724 Woodward in Highland Park, call now, 313-883-3050.
If your teeth are not becoming to you,
then you should be coming to us.
Renee King Jackson sings Mahalia, a soulful toe-tapping musical reflecting the life of the greatest spiritual singer in the world. Sunday, April 21st at the Shriner Silver Garden Center at 24350 Southfield Road in Southfield, Michigan at 7 p.m. For ticket information, call 248-569-8834 or visit the web www.reneekingjackson.com.
I am back, and I do want to sing, but I can't. So I'm going to turn it over to someone who can sing, and we're going to talk about her program, Mahalia. Yes. Renee King Jackson, good morning.
Well, good morning to you.
How are you?
I am really, really great.
Oh, that is wonderful. So Mahalia Jackson, huh?
No relations. Oh, but. Wow.
You could always tell people nobody would know. But anyway,
you are a car.
Oh, don't even, yes. Well, got to keep the day bright because it's so gloomy outside. So, Renee,
yes.
You've been singing probably all your life, haven't you?
I've been singing, yeah, since I was about 5 years old. And
someone discovered you could sing.
My grandparents. You know, we always had to go to church, always had to be on Children's Day, always had to do something in the church.
Yeah.
And so I think that's when they discovered. They used to put me on I'm short, so even at five, you know, I had to be, 2 inches tall. They would put me on a table, And I just sang, "Mama, he treats your daughter mean."
Oh, that was
Ruth Brown.
Ruth Brown. My mother had that song on 78. Oh my God, I'm old. Anyway, so you would sing that, "Mama."
Yes,
you
put and all I put the my hands on my hips. He treats your daughter mean, and oh. they would break up. So.
So, in high school, were you in the choir?
I was in the, mostly not in the choir, but mostly church stuff, you know.
Oh, okay. Mm-hmm. Where'd you go to high school?
Eastern.
Oh, yeah. Eastern High School.
Eastern High School, so right on the boulevard.
Oh, wow. I was going to say it was on the east side.
Yeah, not on the boulevard. It was on Mac and, don't even ask me what that was. Yeah, Mac and the boulevard. Mm-hmm.
Wow. So, Renee.
See how long ago that was.
You did someone else. You did another show.
Yes, I did Esther.
Yes, I
wrote and produced Esther, the Capricorn Princess. Esther Phillips.
I used to love her.
Yes, yes.
What was that song? What was that song? Because I was a teen. I was like 12. There was a song she had out that was so popular. Her voice was so succinct.
Oh, yes. She was a wonderful performer who, because of her demons, I think, did not get the proper or the right recognition, you know.
Well, I liked her. Yeah, I liked her.
A lot of people did. And she died very young.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Is there anything, I mean, do you mind just giving us a few bars of a song this morning?
Of Mahalia?
Yes. Well, first and foremost, everybody in the audience, get ready because we have two tickets for you. To Mahalia, Renee King Jackson sings Mahalia Sunday, a week from this Sunday, at the Shriner Silver Garden Event Center on Southfield Road near 10 Mile, between 9 and 10 Mile, mm-hmm. really at 9.5 Mile on Southfield Road. And tickets are available at the 1917 Bistro, God's World, and online at Renee King Jackson. That's Renee with two E's. King Jackson. And if you want to call, you could call at 248-569-8834, but we have two tickets. Mm-hmm. Can you give us just a little bit of something? Oh, I have a question for you. The person who could answer this question, and I know everybody's going to jump on this. What movie was Mahalia Jackson in that caused everybody to start crying? She was at the end of the movie. You know this movie, The Troubles of the World. Well, anyway, can you give us something?
Soon I will be done with the troubles of this world, troubles of the world. Troubles of this world, oh Lord, and soon we'll be done with the troubles of this world. I'm going home to live with God. No more.
Bravo, bravo. Let's give her a hand, studio audience, let's give her a hand. Okay. My studio audience is here. It's not that big, but they're here. Do we have an answer, Michelle? Okay, because we're going to wait and see if we have an answer and who is that person who answered, and we will interview them real quick before we have to go.
Well, we're going to have it, it's April the 21st.
Right, April
21st. And the doors open at 6. The show starts at 7.
And you have Metro Detroit Area Fellowship singers. Armand is singing. Armand Jackson.
Yes. Okay. And the Greater Grace son.
Now, did we have an answer for that? Yes. It's Betty. Funny. Good morning, Betty. Hello?
Yes.
Hi.
Hi, how are you?
Did you guess the answer?
Yes, ma'am.
It is?
Imitation of Life.
Right.
That's correct. Right. Very good.
Very good. So you have two tickets. Mm-hmm. Can she pick them up here at the station or what?
We will get her information, and both tickets will be at will call.
Okay.
Is that okay? We're going to get your information. Both tickets will be at Will Call. Congratulations, Betty.
Thank you.
I'll be there.
Thank you. Thank you.
Well, that was just wonderful, Renee. Trouble. Oh, but let's talk about the other people. We got time.
Okay.
You know, the thing about you was at 5 years old, you sang and they discovered.
Did she need my information?
Oh, yes. She's getting it.
Okay.
Wait a minute. Let's see. How can we do this? How can we?
All I need is her name, her full name.
Well, we're going to put you on hold. Just hold on. Just hold on, Betty. Anyway, at 5, you were discovered. At 7, I used to sing out the bathroom windows, I hear the cotton. I was singing. My mother told me to shut up. I mean, I think if my mother had encouraged me, I might have been good. But who's to say? You have the Greater Grace Praise Dancers,
yes.
The Brotherhood A Cappella Singers.
Oh, and they are fabulous. I don't know if you've ever heard them.
No.
But they sing with no music, and they sing that old fashion, you know, that old, the old church music. And they are fabulous. They're called the Brotherhood A Cappella Singers.
The historic Little Rock My Ministry,
mm-hmm.
Justin Crutchfield and Pastor Maynard Hurst of Ontario, Canada.
Yes.
This is fantastic, and they can reach you on Facebook at Renee King Jackson, that's two E's, or Renee Sings Mahalia. But Betty won the two tickets,
yes,
and we'll
she
make
did.
Sure, Betty, you will we be assured. Because
yes. Oh, yes.
I put my name behind that.
Oh, no. It'll be at Will Call.
Well, you'll be at Will Call. Your name will be at Will Call and everything. Well, Renee, girl, I needed to hear that this morning.
Well, thank you. And I am so happy to be on your show.
I am so happy you're here. It's about time. It's about time. So everyone, yes, it's about time for me to wrap it up. And I'd like to thank you for joining me. And I'd like to thank my guests, Reginald Perryman and Robert E. Thomas. And of course, Renee King Jackson. Mahalia next week. And we'll be announcing the free makeover for a mother in our audience. Thank you.
God bless.
God bless.
The Brenda Perryman Show is brought to you by Livingston Family Dentistry.
Livingston Family Dentistry knows that good dental care ensures overall wellness, and healthy teeth and gums can perfect your smile. With over 30 years of experience, Dr. Ronald and Dr. Blake Livingston take the time to explain every treatment. Their modern office and friendly staff are committed to making you feel comfortable, informed, and satisfied. Located at 13724 Woodward in Highland Park, call now, 313-883-3050.
If your teeth are not becoming to you,
then you should be coming to us.